All right. Good morning, everybody. We've all got our coffee and or other caffeine or beverage of choice, I hope. Had some chance to do some thinking about the very interesting presentation that we had this morning from Ariel. This morning's conversation, I think, is very timely, given the events of recent months, as well as what we heard last night and what we heard this morning in terms of information that is out there that doesn't always make its way into sort of the public discussion, the public conversation. So we're here today, this morning, for our session on the new media landscape. We'll have two presentations, one from Gillian Steward and one from Brodie Fenlon. They'll each present for about 20 minutes, and then I hope that'll give us a lot of time for some good discussion. For those of you who maybe haven't checked through the guide for the program, there is a discussion guide. We want to have Q&A, definitely, but also want to foster some conversations in these somewhat smaller groups. And so we'll be, my role is to kind of provide some facilitation for that conversation. And so as you're having ideas that occur to you, things you might want to comment on or ask questions about, do make a note of them. And we'll hopefully have enough time at the end to really have a good fulsome conversation about the information that is shared here this morning. I have been a fan of the Parkland Institute for many years, and a couple of years ago joined the board, so I'm very proud to be asked to facilitate the session for you guys, and I hope you'll find it as interesting as I think it's going to be. We'll start with, I think Gillian's going to go first. Yeah. So Gillian Steward is a Calgary-based journalist. She writes a regular column for the Toronto Star as well, and was the 2014-2015 Atkinson Fellow in Public Policy, which enabled her to extensively research and write a series of articles about the Alberta oil sands for the Toronto Star. She's also a former managing editor at the Calgary Herald and teaches journalism at Mount Royal University. And I'll introduce Brodie as well, and then we can maybe have a seamless handoff once Gillian's wrapped up. So Brodie is the Senior Director of Digital News for CBC. He's a graduate of the journalism program at Western University and worked as a reporter for newspapers in London, Ontario, and Toronto before moving on to the digital realm at the Globe and Mail. And in 2011, he helped launch the Huffington Post Canada, where he served as the managing editor of news. So we could give them a round of applause while we get Gillian up here and ready to start.
Good morning. Is this working? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
It's great to be back at Parkland again. I always, whenever I come to this conference, I always feel like I'm really connecting with lots of old friends. So it's great to see everybody out. I'm going to be talking about journalism and local news. And as we heard with Ariel Durangy's talk this morning, which I thought was just brilliant, there's a lot more to local news than fires, accidents, crime, sports, weather, and traffic. I mean, when you listen to somebody like Ariel, you realize that in Alberta, we are living in the center of an extremely interesting time. Like, there's so much going on here that is of importance, not only to the people of this province, but to people across the country and to people in the United States. It's just, it's big. We're in a very important place at this time. And what happens here actually really matters to a lot of people. But I would say, given our media landscape today, particularly in this province, but not just in this province, throughout Canada, we're not really getting the kind of in-depth discussion, news, issues, whatever you want to call it, that we need at this point. And one of the reasons we're not getting it is, I'm not here to tout the wonders of reading your news on paper. That's not why I'm talking about newspaper newsrooms, our newspapers. What I really want to emphasize here is newspaper newsrooms, because newspapers at one point in their history actually made the kind of money that they could fund really expensive journalists and newsrooms. When I was managing editor at the Calgary Herald, for example, we had 180 people in our newsroom. That's 180 people. And, you know, that includes everything from cityside reporters to sports reporters to editors to copy runners, but it was 180 people. And it was by far the largest newsroom in the city. Like, we, you know, the Herald covered everything, or tried to anyway. I wouldn't say that we were perfect or anything like that, but we did have the resources and the people to really do it. Now there's 15 people. Like, how the heck, you know, the city has gotten way bigger and way more complex. The issues are incredibly more complex. And now we have 15 people. And I would say it won't be very long before there are none. You know, the Edmonton Journal and the Calgary Herald are going to disappear, as are the Suns. They're not, you know, in fact, quite frankly, I wish they would just die now, because then something else could come along, maybe, you know. But, you know, holding out hope that they're going to somehow, you know, resurrect or get better or whatever is just futile. It's not going to happen. It's kind of like wishing that Donald Trump would turn into Robert Kennedy Jr. or something. You know, it's not going to happen. Now, I guess I just want to go back to this. I just want to mention that one of the reasons, well, the only reason that we could have, that newspapers could pay for such large newsrooms was this unholy alliance between advertisers and journalism, basically. Journalism is actually, you know, good journalism is an expensive project, and advertising paid for it. That's you know, advertising was the money that came in to the newspaper, journal, you know, the newsroom, and profits are what advertising paid for. And without advertising and without huge, you know, numbers of advertisers, you can't fund the newsroom. It's just not going to happen. And that's basically the problem that we're having now. There is not enough money coming into what is referred to as the business model, which was basically advertisers supporting, you know, news. That business model, or as I would like to, I'd rather call it the unholy alliance, has broken down. It's just not working anymore. And so we have to look to see how we're actually going to support that in the future. And this is, you know, I mean, you all know this. You know, you don't probably need a graph to figure it out or to know what's happening. But this is newspaper circulation in Canada, right? Between 1995 and 2014, with a trend line to 2025. So it's just going down. People are not reading newspapers. They're not reading them in print. They're not, for most cases, they're not even going to the online source, right? They're picking it up from Facebook or some other, you know, social media platform. So the advertisers are abandoning. They're not going there. The advertisers are going to Google and to Facebook and to all that. So the money is just not there, because the circulation's not there, and it's just one. And this is another. This is another graph that will tell you lots. It's a simple graph. But the platforms, which are the distribution, basically, like Facebook and Google and Instagram and all those things, they are growing, okay? But the media that actually supplies content is not growing as fast. It's growing much less, you know, faster. And internet advertising on the bottom is on the bottom there. So that's another picture of what's actually happening and why money is deserting news, or the backing up of journalism and news. So it's, you know, I'm sure you all find that you keep, you know, when you go into the internet, you go into Google or Facebook or whatever, you keep coming across the same kind of pieces all the time, right? Because it's the same things that are circulating. That doesn't mean that there's not a lot more, there's not a lot of interesting sites out there that have a lot of different opinions and a lot of different content, because there are now. But there's nothing like the large sort of impactful kind of media, news media that we were used to, I would say. Okay, and here's another, this is another stat just about advertising and money and news. English language newspaper and magazine revenues appear to have peaked in 2008, which is 8 years ago now, and have plunged from 6.3 billion to 4.5 billion last year, a drop of 28%, which is huge. You know, I remember when I worked at the Calgary Herald, and you know, they track their advertising revenues all the time, and they need it to go up all the time, right? And it's not; it's going down, and it's going down by relatively large amounts. And there doesn't appear to be any, I don't know, there doesn't appear any end in sight, as it says there. If you're interested in looking at how bad the local news situation is, and as I say, when I'm talking about local news, I'm not talking about, you know, crime and fires and accidents. I'm really talking about something a lot more weightier than that. This is a... this is a research project at Ryerson University, which is carried out by April Lindgren. And she's actually following all across the country where newspapers, radio stations, online publications have disappeared. She tracks them all. And if you want to go into there, you can find out more, locally what's happening. It's just a really interesting site, and I'm really glad to see that somebody's actually tracking that. She calls it news poverty, which I think is actually a good term. Next. Okay, here's another, some more stats about where people are getting their news, and particularly young people. Millennials or anybody born after 1980, they most often hear about their news on social media. And I have to tell you, I was talking to a fourth year journalism student in Calgary the other day, and I said to her, where do you get your news? And she said, Facebook. They go on I'm not being critical here, I'm just saying it as a fact. They don't go to the Calgary Herald website, they don't go to the Globe and Mail website, they don't go to the New York Times, they go to Facebook. And I said to her, well, how do you know what's actually going on in the city? And she said, well, it'll turn up, you know, it'll turn up on Facebook. Anyway, and then after that, if they see something on Facebook, then people go to a search engine. They don't go to the actual site where the article or the news item appeared. And 5% go to a newspaper. And I've heard even a prof at U of C say to me he only reads Twitter, because you know people on Twitter will post things, right? They post things from certain publications, and then that's the way he reads. He doesn't actually go to the original site anymore. So you can see why advertisers are moving, where they're moving away from the producers of news, and they're moving to the platforms. Now, I don't want to leave everybody in despair, because I think our situation in Alberta is really bad. It's terrible. As I said earlier, we have so much going on here and so much at stake, and we're getting so, you know, and I think Ariel's talk really, if anything, pointed out to me how we just, you know, we're just so weak as a community when it comes to getting really, impactful, strong, accurate information and the larger picture. But here, I'm going to talk about some of the newer models, because advertising's apparently not working anymore. Here's one. It's from the United States. Is it going to come up? Oh, it's called ProPublica. And it is actually funded by foundations. Okay, the money is coming from foundations. They have 45 journalists, and they're all investigative journalists. So what they do is they decide what issue or what person or whatever they want to focus on in terms of doing an in-depth kind of investigation. And then when they have come up with their with an article, with their story complete, then they give it away to any publication that wants it. So if if the Calgary Herald or the Journal or a newspaper in the United States, if they wanted that article, they can have it for nothing. That's what they do, and they've been going for several years now, and they are supported by a foundation. Okay, next. Now this one, and it's not just because it's from Texas, but I think is particularly applicable to Alberta. It's a statewide online publication which it's only focused on government and policy, right? That's basically all that they focus on, and they do it in a lot of detail. They are funded by what they call members, by donors, and by foundations. They raise something like $27 million to get this going through that kind of fundraising, and that's how they keep going. They have, besides having this publication, they have members and they member events where they, discuss certain topics or do certain things or bring certain people to talk about topics. I really, in Alberta these days, this would be, I think, something that we really need. Does any of you remember when there actually was a newspaper called The Albertan? Yeah. I think we could really use something like that now so that we can talk about what's happening in this province and in all parts of this province, right? And particularly what's happening in government, but also, policy ideas, who's doing what, everything, right? I think we could really use that. So that's the Texas Tribune. This is Blendl. Does anybody know what Blendl is? Blendl is called the iTunes of journalism, and it's basically puts together all kinds of publications, and then if you want an article from one of those publications, you pay for it. I think it's like 25 cents or something if you want to read it. So that's another model, and apparently it's working quite well. People are paying per article for what they want to read. I'm not sure it's a good local model, but the per article model might work here. And this is De Correspondent, which is from the Netherlands. It's based in Amsterdam. And they've raised money through crowdfunding. They raised over $1 million, $1.7 million. They're a totally online source. And it's through fundraising, memberships, all that kind of thing. So that's another one. Now, in Canada, we have the TAI, which I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with. It's based in Vancouver, and I think it's a really good publication, but it does focus mostly on the West Coast. They, again, are funded by a foundation, and they have donations and that kind of thing, but basically their money comes from a foundation. One of the problems in Canada, as opposed to the United States, is that we don't have foundations with the kind of money that they have in the United States. We just don't. So that's a problem for us in terms of, raising that kind of money. There's another Canadian example. It's called Ricochet. And again, it's based in Quebec. It's interesting, it's divided its kind of news streams into four things, which is Canada, Quebec, Indigenous, and international. And that's the way they divide their their story streams. And they again are a crowdsource. Yeah, and they've raised enough money to do that. You know, and I think that's one of the keys here is, I think in this, you know, the world of citizen journalism, we've come to think maybe that we can, people can just get online and can actually tell everybody what's going on. But actually you do need people, you need experts, you need people who know what they're talking about. You need research, you need time, you need money to actually dig into a lot of things. So these are some examples. I encourage you, there is a new book out. It's just been published and it's called No News is Bad News. And it's by Ian Gill, who is a BC journalist. And it's all about Canada's media collapse. It's not about the United States or anywhere else. It's all about what's happening here with lots of detail and lots of you know, stats and numbers and people and ideas. I took a lot of the ideas for what I told you from here. It's published by Greystone Books on the West Coast. So I would encourage you to read it if you're really interested in this topic, and I hope you are, because we definitely need something to happen in Alberta, or who knows what's going to happen. Thank you.
All right. Hi, everyone. Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. It's my first time at this university, and it's a thrill. So I oversee digital news at CBC. That means CBCNews.ca, the website. I oversee the news apps on iOS and Android, and our social media efforts. And I'm going to spend 20 minutes to kind of burn through some of the big issues and the fundamental changes that are happening to the way that digital news is distributed and consumed. And there are really two big forces at play for us and for all media right now. One is the smartphone and the other is social media. So I'm going to start with the smartphone. And one way to talk about it is that, which is spaghetti. Now, don't worry about seeing what this graph is. I'll explain it to you. And it's not mine. It's from a group called Asimco. But it shows you the adoption rate of technology, personal technology, everything from washers and dryers to microwaves to VCRs to television to the smartphone. And it shows you how long it took from something to go from 10% of the population having it to 90%. And the big takeaway is just that this line, this big red line, is the smartphone. There has never been anything that has been adopted as quickly by as many people as the smartphone. The only thing that comes close is television in the 50s. Not just the adoption rate is astounding, but it's also our most valued piece of personal technology. If you survey most demographics, we'll say it's the thing they care about the most. And you in this room, I know, share my own anxiety when I forget my phone at home. It starts to get impossible to live your day. It's an important device. So for news organizations, everyone knows that you need to be winning the phone. This comes from the New York Times vision statement that was in October of 2015, and they said, if we don't win the phone, we don't win. We lose the war. For CBC, we were obviously aware of the mobile revolution, and we jumped in and got very serious about it in about 2012, 2013. This graph shows you where our visits come from to the desktop version of our website, which would be desktop and laptop computers. The mobile web is mostly the phone, and the app, of course, is a mobile device too. And you can just see the red and purple line. The growth has been amazing. In fact, today, every day, about 70% of the visits to CBC News stories come from a mobile device. And that's incredible, because I mean, I've been at CBC for about 3.5 years. I remember talking about, when are we going to hit the 50% mark? Won't that be the game changer? Well, we've blown through that. Now it's 70%. So, I use GIFs. I apologize, but you have to deal with it. So, what are the implications of the smartphone? So, we'll start with just that piece of technology. Well, one is just the hardware is different. So, gone is your conventional keyboard. Gone is the mouse. And diminished are your web browsers, right? People don't bookmark pages on this thing. What do you use? You use an app. The app is your interface to the internet. Now, apps are complicated things. To build them, you need engineers. Who's got engineers? Tech companies. And tech companies also happen to make phones. So in this world, the tech company or Silicon Valley is privileged. The other thing about the phone is it's an incredible collection of data, personal data. It knows where you are. It can geolocate you to a point on a map. It knows how often you're on it, what you're doing on it. And app makers take that information and they do two things. One, they create even better apps. They iterate. And so your apps become more intuitive, more personalized, and then one day you wake up and your phone is telling you that you're late for your appointment and traffic's going to be light. And you don't even know where that came from, but it's coming from this collection of your personal data. The other thing that happens is that those companies take that data and sell it to advertisers. The challenge for media, of course, is that we're not that kind of a company. We tell stories. We don't create tech, and we don't do it well, and we don't collect personal data in that way. So we have been at a disadvantage as the audience migrates to this tool. The other thing that is a problem for media is that most of us have about 24 apps on our phone, but we only use 4 or 5 of them daily. If you look at the most used apps on the phone last year, 9 of the 10 are owned by Google and Facebook, and then Apple has one in there. So that's a difficult place to compete as a news organization. One, you have to be big if you're going to be making apps, right? So CBC makes a pretty good app, but real challenge for local news organization or an independent news company to make an app. You're going to have to rely on an outsider. And then to get to be the one that people are using regularly is an even higher bar. So Facebook and Google dominate, and small media are disadvantaged. The other thing is that this tool demands speed. Google says that, and I believe it, that if a page doesn't load within 3 seconds, 40% of the audience leaves. They bail. So these companies say to organizations like CBC and all media that you're not fast enough on mobile. You're too slow. And they'll say, Facebook, for instance, says, we're going to create something called instant articles for the phone. Let us build the story page for you. Give us your content. We'll put it and we'll make it look like CBC News, but we'll host it in our environment. It'll be our page, and when the audience clicks on it, it'll load quickly. And guess what it does? It's a great user experience. But the thing is, people are staying within the Facebook world when they enter those stories. So I'm just going to show you an example of a CBC instant article. And you'll know it's an instant, you'll know it's an instant article, but you see the little lightning bolts. If you're on Facebook and you're in your feed on the phone, you see that little lightning bolt, it means it's an instant article. So I asked my wife, she came down one morning, I said, just open these two stories at the same time for me. I didn't tell her what the experiment was. On the left here is our mobile website. Okay, and on the right is the same story as an instant article. Okay, you get the point. So two takeaways. Yes, this was really fast, but hold on for a second. This isn't that slow, right? That's pretty good. For a mobile web. Give me a break. But the bigger takeaway for me was my wife, do you see how she tapped it again? That kind of, what? It's broken. It's not loading. And that behavior, that impulse is real. And so again, for a media company, Facebook, which spends $1 billion a year on research and development, they can create amazing products like that. A news organization, not so much. And so we have this. We have instant articles. Apple News has its product, similar kind of thing. And Google created accelerated mobile pages. Same idea, a little different, but again, fast loading versions of your story. And then Google says, this is so important to us that if you don't take part in this, you're not going to surface in search results anymore on a phone. So look at your phone when you start to search something now. You're going to see a little carousel. These are called AMP pages. And if you're a media company that you didn't take part in the AMP program, well, good luck getting discovered. So those players are calling the shots in terms of discovery and distribution of news. The other big, big thing is that this device is a social media platform in a huge way. And I'm going to illustrate that with our own traffic and audience at CBC. On the left, you're going to see where the audience comes to us when they're accessing the desktop version of our website. So this is laptops and computers. And then I'll compare it to where the audience comes from to the mobile version of our website. So desktop looks like this. The big blue chunk is what we call type bookmark. That's people who know our URL, cbcnews.ca, where their home screen, they've bookmarked us, they have the tab in the browser. They're coming to us directly. The red chunk, about a quarter of the audience comes from Google. Well, search engines, but primarily Google. The light blue chunk is other websites, blogs, anyone that links to us. And then the green chunk represents social media. Okay, got it? Now watch the green on the mobile version of the website. So suddenly, it's a social media audience that's coming to our website through on the phone, right? It shows you the impact of social media on that device. And of the part that we can track, some of it we can't. We know there's messengers and different programs in there, but Facebook is the behemoth. Social media, as Gillian said, is increasingly becoming the source for news. Certainly for millennials last year, millennials said for the first time that more get their news from social media than television, and that is broadening out across all demographics. In the US, we know that 40% of all Americans say they get news from Facebook. So, what are the implications of a social media distribution of news? Well, first let's talk about Facebook. Facebook is a massive, massive player in the distribution of news. 1.8 billion monthly users, and obviously after this election you've seen all kinds of conversation about the impact or what role Facebook played in that result. In Canada, it's the same story. So this is just a snapshot of 1 month in Canada. These are millennials, and it shows you what social networks were used by millennials, or at least were touched, anyone who was online who was a millennial in July. Facebook is number one, reaching on this axis more than 90% of the available audience, and on this axis shows you time spent. Look how much time people are spending on that platform. It's a very engaging platform. It's no different, it's no different for 35 to 54. Looks very similar, right? We spend a lot of time on Facebook, and a lot of people are on it. So what does it mean? For a news organization, it means you gotta be in Facebook, for sure. And we do all kinds of stuff on Facebook. We break news there, we call the election. We do a lot of video, because Facebook likes video. We do Facebook Lives. We even experiment with putting radio on Facebook. Now, and it's paid off for us in some ways. We are one of the biggest publishers, CBC News is, on Facebook in the English-speaking world. We're the only Canadian on this list, and it includes everyone from the Huffington Post to CNN on down. And it's measuring engagement, so likes, shares, commenting. We're a big player, but the big but is this. Facebook favors shareability over public interest. And it favors scale over the niche, or in the case of news, meaning local news. And this is the dilemma. So I'm going to end with a few points to think about as we move to this world of the phone and social media and increasingly Facebook, some things we should be talking about. One is that the filter bubble, you've heard the filter bubble, it's real. There's no doubt. If you live your life on Facebook and you were consuming news about the election, the US election on Facebook, and you're completely shocked and surprised by the election of Donald Trump, you are living in the filter bubble. And if you are not surprised at all that it's a no-brainer and how could anyone possibly elect Clinton, you are also living in the filter bubble. That bubble, your window in the world is narrowed by an algorithm. And it's we don't know what that how it works, we just know parts and pieces of it. But it favors what your interests are, what your peer group cares about, the kinds of things you've opened and read in the past, and it continues to serve that that need, right? So you start to see a smaller and smaller window of the world. And it's a great experience because it's sorting the world by your interests, but it's not sharing or at least exposing you to the wider stuff. So filter bubble is real. We end up kind of talking to ourselves, right? Like-minded people sharing like-minded things. The second, as Julian's talked about, is ads and revenue. The thing about Facebook and Google is they have reams of data on you. if you've used any of their products. And you can actually request it. A colleague of mine requested his personal data from Google, and he got pages and pages back, including years of his travel back and forth from work, time of day, everything. Data, I mean, we talk about big pharma and, you know, big agriculture. Big data is the thing that we should all be talking about. These companies have massive amounts of data on us, and they and that's why they're so effective for people that want to sell stuff. So Facebook and Google take 85 cents, some estimates are 85 cents of every ad dollar spent digitally right away, which means the whole model that Gillian talked about is upended for traditional journalism. We're not making money because the money is going to Facebook and Google because they're so much better at serving ads to specific audiences. And believe me, they can pin, I mean, you can be an advertiser and say, I would like to target this cat food to 40-year-old women living in the bottom half of Toronto who drive Ford Chevys. Yes, got it, or what, I'm sorry, Ford Chevys, but you know what I mean. that's how specific you can get. A traditional media company can't. Now, one of the things you'll see media that survive this change is that they're going to get better about collecting data because they need to be able to compete on that. So the third implication is the that media becomes enslaved to the algorithm of Facebook. We create content that we know is going to, we do stories the way we always do stories, but we have to sell them, package them, headline them, use photos that appeal to the feed, that stop your thumb. We sometimes talk about thumb-stopping content. When Facebook decides, you know what, one day it says, we're going to get into video, we want to win video, we're going to take on YouTube and Google and win video. Well, God help you if you don't produce video, because suddenly the only thing you're seeing in your Facebook feed is video. And I don't know if it's like this with your feed, but I'm seeing increasingly more and more video to the point where your Facebook news feed will probably end up being television. But that means that media companies have to jump. And good luck if you're a small niche local newspaper. I mean, now you need to be in the video game. If you're not, you're going to kind of disappear from that feed because it's not Facebook's interest, right? Facebook wants video. Same thing happened with live video. And now, if you're on Facebook, you see live video all the time in your feed. Finally, and by the way, then Facebook decides maybe one day it's not even interested in news anymore. So they make a change to their algorithm. This was earlier this year. They decided we're gonna favor personal stuff, your family photos, your trips, your musings, and we'll favor that over news. And sure enough, the media freak out because the media really depend on Facebook for audience. And so, yes, all kinds of stories about this change to the algorithm. And what happens is audience starts to decline for a lot of players that have relied on Facebook for their audience. I like this quote, Facebook may be everything to the media, but the media is just one of many types of content on Facebook. The final thing to say is that you're hearing a lot about fake news, right? News in the feed looks like cat videos and your pictures of your vacation, and it looks like fake news. Here's fake news. Everyone talked about this piece, right? And here's real news. Headline, blurb, source, it all looks the same. So the value, the brand proposition of news is diminished in this feed environment. How do you discern quality from crap? And how do you discern real from fake? Not easy. And make no mistake, we are all guilty of being browsers, right? We consume headlines and pictures. How often do you stop and go in? So Facebook needs to own up to the fact that it's a major media company. It so far refuses to acknowledge that. It says we're just a platform and everyone can use us. But the truth is, this is where people go for news. So they need to own up, I think, to their responsibility to help the audience discern what is real and what is not. What is good and what is not. Finally, I'll just end. Oh, and by the way, this election, one great thing about the election is that it has really created some focus on the Facebook feed. And Facebook and Google are having to wear some of this. Regardless of where you fall on the political spectrum, these companies are having to own up to this issue. This is not a new story. It's been in media and academic circles for some time, but now it's happening more broadly. People are talking about, what am I actually seeing in this feed? never mind, and you have to leave, put aside at least the whole question of do people even care if it's fake? And I would argue that at least in this election, I don't think people really cared. I think people were more interested in the feeling and confirmation of their own biases or their own views on the election. That's another conversation, but in terms of what is real or not, Facebook's feeling the heat and it's gonna have to do something about it. For CBC, in terms of where we put our effort, our strategy is twofold. It's really, there's no doubt, mass audience in social platforms and in apps. We need to be there, we will be there, but we are doing our best to convince the audience to come back to our owned and operated properties where we think the priorities of CBC News reflect the priorities of an engaged citizen living in Canada who needs to know not just the news they want to know, but the news they should know. And I just use an example. This week we had a reporter in Aleppo, one of the few Western reporters to be in Syria. And Syria does not share. You will not see her stories in your feed unless there's some remarkable, gut-wrenching photo of a little boy sitting after, you know, a bombing. And we all saw that. But that's the kind of thing now that shares, not just straight, normal journalism. And so I encourage all of us to remember that and to seek out the journalism that really matters. How'd I do? I'm okay? Great.
My favorite kind of panel is smart and punctual. Fantastic. That actually leaves us a great deal of time. We've got about half an hour for the Q&A / discussion period. I would invite people to be thoughtful in their questions and their comments, to keep them brief and concise so that we can fit lots of different elements into it and hear from lots of different people. We do have lovely volunteers here at the front with microphones to grab your questions. So we'll just wait for some hands to shoot up. There's one over there first. That was the first one. And then we'll go to this gentleman in the front.
Hi, thank you so much. Is this coming through? I found both of these presentations extremely interesting. I'm of an age where I need this kind of presentation in order to understand what's really going on when I'm online and when I'm using my phone and so on. I have a question that I hope both of you could touch on, and it's going to sound terribly innocent. For the past month or so, I've been sort of obsessed with a phenomenon that you just gave me a name to because I hadn't heard it before, the bubble, the filter thing. Because it's very obvious, it became obvious to me that I live in such a bubble. And the only time I got to hear what the others were thinking was when the trolls would get into the comments section of the articles I was reading. And then I thought, wow. Well, then I started to ask myself, because I'm just an individual, I'm no longer involved with any organizations other than as a supporter in which I can initiate something. So as an individual, I do things like try to reduce my footprint ecologically and this and that. And as a citizen, an individual citizen, I started asking myself right away, how can I get into the other bubble? How can I bring some facts that I heard in my bubble to those people, you know? The first thought was I could become one of those awful trolls. And no, I don't want to do that. What I want to hear about from you instead is what would be a very large scale and perhaps a long-term strategy for undermining this phenomenon, even though it's owned and organized by the richest corporations in the world. I realize, and they have all the technical expertise, they have everything. But what could happen that might challenge that paradigm of each of us now living in a bubble and being undermined in our political influence as citizens?
You talked about the bubble, so go ahead.
Thanks.
That's a big question.
That is that's a difficult question. I don't know what the answer is, but one thing is to, one, get insight into what is happening on the bubble that's not yours. I was on a panel yesterday with a woman who set up a fake profile on Facebook and made this person, a young woman living in Alabama, I think, and conservative-leaning, and started to like just everything that was pro-Trump, and then got a completely different feed. right? And a completely different source of information. To be honest, the biggest worry I have right now is, at least after through this the course of the election, I'm not sure people are interested in facts, actually. I'm not sure we're in a place right now, you'll hear the term post-truth, where we're more about feelings and the success. If you look, there's a great study done by a guy at BuzzFeed, Craig Silverman, he's a Canadian. He looked at the stories in the last 3 weeks of the campaign, the ones that shared were fake news, right? Outrageous kind of headlines. And they shared far better than mainstream media stories on the election. And I think it's because it was appealing to this gut, visceral feeling of anger or resentment or frustration with the system. There are all kinds of motivations, for sure. But I don't think people actually... At least at this time, we're ready for an argument over facts. And that's I think, probably the biggest worry I have. But I also think, you know, you talk about the comment threads, and CBC's had lots of issues with comments. I also think most users look at those for what they are, and again, dismiss them and don't engage with them and don't really... Usually we look at comments to almost gut check our own views and say, yep, I'm on the right side, and that's a nut bar who's ranting in the thread. So I think there's a much bigger issue here at play, and it's just about the status of debate and facts and truth. And I don't know. Do you?
Well, I just wanted to bring it back to more of a local lens. Because I think in Alberta what's happening right now is we are becoming incredibly polarized. I mean, we've moved from, you know, the one-party state where everybody was supposed to, or, you know, think alike, and now we've become incredibly polarized, right? And so you have one side and the other side, and, you know, I agree with you. You kind of find out about each other from reading comments or, you know, from trolls and things like that. But... I really think that we, you know, more than ever in this place, we need good journalism, good media, which can actually talk about all of it, right? Not just one side and then the other side, because I think we're headed, you know, to a pretty vicious kind of environment. I mean, in one way, it's, I would say, compared to the one-party state, at least we're in competitive politics now. But yeah, we have to be really careful that we're not just closing off to one side, right? Or at least not trying to create, avenues of discussion that are civilized. Which means I don't really have a solution, but anyway.
All right, this gentleman in the front.
My name is Bernard. Thank you for your insightful uncovering of the new 1600 state of publishing, when there were virtually no safeguards in terms of truth and verifiable information. Two questions. The first one is, my position is boycott Facebook. The Zuck sucks. I don't go there. I don't use it. I don't need it. I don't want it. What are the problems with my position? That's the first question. Second question is, can Google find me if I shut my cell phone off?
Those are great questions. It's interesting. I mean, I think that's a principled stand on Facebook. I actually think probably if you were really seized with this issue, you might actually think about the people who advertise on Facebook, and maybe that is one. That's one place you go, because ultimately these companies are about making money, and if it became a concern for a wide number of people about what's happening in the Facebook feed, and some of that energy was directed at the advertisers who use Facebook, perhaps there would be some pressure there, but Facebook is also, it's easy to be down on Facebook. A few years ago, we would have all been talking about Google, and we were down on Google, and before that, other things. Facebook is also, for those who do use it, it can be a great tool. One of the reasons it's great is that it helps sort for people, this incredible amount of information, and news media are part of that problem. We publish thousands of articles. We've done so every day. We do that because for a long time that was the way to build audience. We valued, you know, bulk page views because they serve ads. So it's a big, messy problem. And Facebook does solve that problem for a lot of people. It helps kind of focus in on what is going to be most relevant to you. But good on you. And as for Google, well, yeah, I think we rely on these tools. We've kind of turned it over, our data, to them almost willingly, or maybe not willingly, but we just did it, and now we use these tools. They're becoming so useful to us. I think I use an app called Waze when I'm in Toronto every day. It crowdsources thousands of cars around me who are using information fed to the app on their location, and I can figure out the best route home. So it's useful to me, even though it kind of freaks me out that I'm beaming my location all the time, regardless of whether that app is open or not. I have this, you know, this conflicted relationship with the data. But I don't think, I think we're going to get to a point where the society won't function without these companies. They've got so much on us now. You know, they can actually predict, for instance, your health better than doctors can. There was a recent experiment, I can't remember, I think it was Microsoft, that was able to just diagnose you based on your search history and behavior on the internet. And so think through where that will go in terms of healthcare or law. I think it's too late.
I'd just like to add a short thing. I'm one of these old-fashioned people that actually goes directly to the source. I actually go to news sites, but I also pay for them, right? Like, I have a subscription. And I think that's the other thing, too. I mean, you can get it from Facebook. It doesn't cost you anything. Somebody sends it to you, right? You don't pay. Well, I think, that if you really want good or what you consider to be informative, factual information, people are going to have to pay for it. You know, all the sites that I put up there, people are paying. You got to put your money on the line.
Thanks. There's a question up at the front here.
Yes, I wanted to know.
Sorry? I am, yes.
Okay, it's hard to catch your eye.
That's okay.
I'm curious to know if journalism is, and media is sort of in a decline. I'm wondering about the journalism students who are coming through post-secondary system now. Are we prepping them for a job, an actual job that's going to possibly exist? And what does that job look like? Or are the post-secondary institutions just blithely taking their tuition and really they're not going to emerge with a viable career? Can you speak to that?
Yeah, no, it's a real problem in the journalism schools because, for certain, the faculty are well aware of what the situation is and how difficult it is to get a good, well-paying job in the journalism field. The students are well aware because they know that they're going to have a hard time finding jobs. Most journalism programs have an internship program where part of your course is to actually go out and work in a news media organization. What the students are finding is that they either don't get paid or they get paid so little that they can't afford it, right? I mean, I've had students say to me, you know, I'd really like to go and intern at XYZ Weekly somewhere. They've offered me a job, but I can't afford it. Like, I'm going to have to, you know, be a server or do something else during the summer so I can earn enough money to go to school. Right, so it is a real issue. On the other hand, I think the students that I see, they're very adept, obviously, at all the technology and all the social media and all that stuff. So in a way, they're the ones that are going to discover new ways to use journalism and to get it the way they want it. So you have to kind of balance that out. Because they are very adept, but it's a bleak world for them in terms of any kind of jobs. So I think what happens is, you know, people who teach journalism, we tend to focus on, okay, well, at least we can teach them critical thinking, right? At least if we get them out there, critical thinking, even if they go to work for a nonprofit or an oil company, their brains will be they'll see things through maybe a different lens.
Excellent. So there was a question up at the back, and then we'll come over here to the side. Oh, sorry.
I'm just wondering how much, you know, your observations as media people are turning the mirror back on the media itself. It seems to me over the course of my lifetime that I've seen a decline in the Fourth Estate project that media was really designed to be in the first place, and whether, you know, it's the corporatization of the media, the editorial prescriptions that leave a whole bunch of stuff on the cutting room floor. Because I guess I look at this situation now and wonder if we're not simply graduating public relations people to fit into the models that you've just very eloquently described, or whether we're producing journalists who go out and kick people's asses who need to have it kicked, including Facebook and Google and all that. And understandably, I mean, there's that big economic pressure on the institutions to sort of conform, but you know, even CBC, who used to be the bastion for me, I mean, I thought Peter Mansbridge was typically soft on Stephen Harper, even when CBC itself was being attacked. So I mean, I guess I worry a bit about what does become fact, even if we're in a post-fact thing. There's a certain ethic in journalism that helped protect the public, and there was a certain I guess, way of doing the journalism business. And I don't know, as insiders, if you feel or saw the same thing or whether I'm just kind of out there.
Well, there, you know, it's a bit another big question, right? I think you have to, I mean, in what I would describe as really strong journalistic enterprises, there always was a link between the public interest, right, and journalism, right? And then I think you could see a big change actually when television came along, because television was a news and an entertainment medium, and you know, so then you could see newspapers with their huge newsrooms actually trying to adapt to that landscape, right, and provide more entertainment, more, you know, lighter kind of content. And so then you had, you know, we have the infotainment world, right, which we And I think journalism in many ways got really watered down. And we had, you know, really qualified journalists going out and covering, you know, cat shows or whatever, you know, you wanna, I know cats are really popular on the internet, so, or video, or YouTube, but I mean, we've seen a watering down in many ways of journalism. Not that it's always been this great bastion of, you know, integrity and everything, because it certainly has had its problems. But I agree with you that this idea that, you know, you need to train people or educate people so they can really go out and kick ass where it needs to happen, is kind of going by the wayside. You know, there's very much the PR attitude to everything, right? And that's why, you know, when you hear somebody like Ariel Durange get up and speak, like, it kind of shocks you, you know, because we just don't hear that anymore. And yet, we should, for sure.
I'll just add that I think the journalists I see, and I'm in a place that's, I feel so fortunate that it has public investment. And so we still are, actually CBC News, it's a mixed model of revenue. But there's this foundation of the public investment in it that allows us to at least some of these pressures aren't as acute. I don't think, what I see, the journalists are in our shop are hungry as ever and want to go after. But the problem, especially outside of CBC, but is that journalism is so expensive to do the kind you're talking about. Not just the time to do it, the time to dig and do it well, but you also need to have be backed by legal support, right? I mean, this is one issue that doesn't get enough airtime. As revenues decline, as newspapers start to shrink, one of the cost pressures is legal. Their legal department, or the ability to defend yourself against lawsuits. And make no mistake, I mean, anywhere that good journalism is happening, the threat of a lawsuit is right around the corner. It goes hand in hand, and you have to be ready. So a worry, I think, for all of us is that, again, these pressures mean that perhaps the impulse to go hard, to take on anyone, is pulls back a bit when you know that everything is going to come with a giant bill for your legal defense.
Was there a question down here? Sorry. I know Bill had one, but there are a few people ahead of you. So we will go over to that side of the room and then maybe come back to this side. Oh, sorry. But did you have? Yes? Okay. We'll get you first then.
Hi. I spend too much time on Facebook. but I had a couple of comments. One was, I'm really concerned about the lack of local news. And I saw the other day the Edmonton Journal had a post up saying, oops, we're sorry, we printed in our print edition the local Toronto weather. Here's the link to the local Edmonton weather. That's just, I think, a sign of how little local information and local people working on news that we have. But I also wanted to ask a question around headlines and clickbaity things, because there was an article that was going around Facebook recently where someone had made a list of what they titled as false, misleading, or clickbaity news sites. And I commented to the friend who had posted it that I found the article itself to be really clickbaity in its headline and quite kind of misleading in the information it was presenting, because it was lumping together a wide range of different sites. So everything from sites that were telling out and out lies to sites that the author just considered to have clickbaity headlines, and so trying to get more clicks, and maybe their headlines were not as serious journalism as the person thought they should be. And someone in the thread was saying to me, oh no, it's not misleading because people will take the time to actually read the article and look at the notations about what the person is saying about those sites. And then at another point in the thread, literally the same person was gleefully commenting about a site that they didn't like that was on the list. And if you read the list, that site was only accused of having clickbaity headlines, not actually putting out any false information. So I'm wondering about the challenges of that for news organizations. How do you balance trying to make headlines that people will click on because of these measurements of engagement that Facebook has, et cetera? You need those clicks to be able to get information out to people. And that mix of things and challenges.
That's great. That's a lot there. You're right to identify the importance of the headline, for instance. It was one of the critical pieces of what we do in this new world of digital feeds. And to give Facebook some credit, they have tried to feed into their algorithm measures that would downplay clickbait and also downplay garbage. One of the things they measure is when you enter into a story, how long do you spend in it? They take that as a cue for quality. The longer you spend in it, the higher quality they assume that piece is. And so you've seen clickbait kind of get diminished in the feed as a result of some of those measures. So they've taken it on. But there's no doubt that you have to, again, we live in a world of so much information. You have to be able to stop people. Our approach is that we're not going to write boring headlines. We want people to read our stories, but we don't want to oversell or underdeliver or promise something that we're not going to deliver. And there's a balance there, but you have to stop people. People are so busy, they're consuming so much, it's washing over them. How do you say, stop, hold on, take a look at this, it's important, you're going to want to know about it. And it's a real challenge. The other thing just to touch on is you've identified the other problem is, who is the arbiter of what is real and what is crap and what is quality and not? This is a really thorny issue, right? And this is one of the reasons Facebook doesn't want to say that it's a media company, because it doesn't want to be put in that position. Because that position then comes with all kinds of responsibilities that traditional mainstream media have been have lived for years, right? We are arbiters. We say, this is a story worthy of your time, and this isn't. We make those editorial choices, and we have to defend them publicly. Facebook doesn't want to be a part of that right now. And it's not easy. I don't know what the answer is. If Facebook, how does Facebook assure or decide what it's going to favor or give attention to in the feed based on quality? That's a pretty tricky game. How do you make sure marginal voices don't appear? I mean, one of the great things about Facebook recently has been Black Lives Matter. There's a story that is not new. It's been going on for decades. Mainstream media weren't on it, but suddenly it becomes a real live issue because the people most impacted, directly impacted, are able to live stream into that platform their experience in real time. Well, that's a pretty incredible thing. So for all the bad of this world, there's lots of good too, right? I mean, everybody can be a publisher. The challenge now is getting discovered. It's easier today to be a media entity. Every one of us is. The problem is we're relying on these algorithms to determine what gets seen and shared.
Great. And our last question today over there. She's had her mic in the hand for a while.
No pressure. So. I really like this talk, but I can't help but feel a bit skeptical because when I was an undergrad, we were talking about similar issues, but in a different way. So when we talk about newspaper and media, we talk about media conglomerates, so Reuters, Time Warner, and Clear Channel. And, you know, it's kind of, I see parallels between the problems then and the problems now. And meanwhile, when I was younger, even the bubble existed. So I never read National Post because I thought it was conservative tripe, and I would read the Toronto Star instead. So I feel like the issue here is not what to consume, but how to consume and how to become literate, media literate. And I think that's a term that everyone talks about in terms of importance, but no one exactly knows what it is. So I'm curious to know that as journalists, what are your hallmarks to determine whether you think that someone would be literate or media literate or can think critically? Because I think this is really what's heart of the matter here. And I think that this is what's something that we should expect out of everyone.
Well, that's another big question, right? You want to know what the criteria for being media literate? Is that what you're saying? Wow. I think we've been talking this morning a lot about facts. And I think that, you know, I know when I read or when I watch something, when I watch a video, I'm personally looking to see if the facts add up, right? And maybe, you know, like when Ariel was talking this morning, because I did a lot of research into the oil sands and I published these articles in the Toronto Star, I actually know quite a bit about the oil sands. And so when I'm listening to her, I'm going, yeah, check. In many ways, it requires that you know something about the topic to start with. The other thing that I found is that I try, I read people who I trust, right? I read them for a while, and then I can judge whether or not they are producing evidence or they're producing a valid point of view or whatever. Like I can go to certain people, right? And I think the other thing in terms of a media organization is, are they willing to give me all sides, not both sides, all sides of an issue, you know? When I read the New York Times, for example, yeah, they will bring up the conservative point of view all the time. Good, I need to know what that is, right?
Yeah. That's a great question because I feel a little bit the same way. Basically what you're saying, so what else is new? I mean, instead of press barons and broadcast conglomerates, now we're talking Facebook and Google. But the distribution and consumption of news is just being mediated by another company or thing, and profit is the motive. And that's the story of media forever. So you're right. I do think one thing we need to do is just start to re-educate or remind people what journalism is. I think we maybe have lost that. We operate on the assumption that people understand that we're double sourcing our stories, that we have, in the case of CBC News, journalistic standards and practices, this code that we get have to defend with through an ombudsman, and that we issue corrections when we're transparent about the mistakes we make. All these things that we do that we assume people value and know why we do them, but I actually don't know if they do know that. I don't know if most people know that. And maybe it's on us to start to talk about what we do, how we work, to be transparent about it, and to tell people why it matters, why you should value the fact that we're not running something until we have two sources. simple journalistic stuff that I've kind of just assumed the audience knows and cares about. I'm not sure they do.
Thank you. Just a few announcements before we wrap up the session today. One is that lunch will be on the other side of this building, so not this corridor, but the one on the other side of the large auditorium. And I hope that our panelists will be able to stick around for lunch so that those of you who didn't get your questions answered here in this forum would maybe have some time to find them in the crowd and have a chat with them. I also wanted to say that we want to encourage the Parkland Institute to continue with this amazing work. One of the things, even long before I became a board member, I became a monthly supporter because I went to a session in Calgary, and one of their staff members was talking about the impact and the reach that the Parkland Institute had in the news media here in Alberta and across Canada in terms of their ability to get their research out into the world. And that to me was really impactful, because not only is the research worthwhile doing for research sake and to get this information that we need, but their reach and being able to get it out into the public. And so if it is available to you and you've got some resources that you could share, definitely consider becoming either a monthly supporter or giving a one-time donation to the Parkland so that we can continue getting this perspective and point of view out into the world. I wanted to thank our speakers. We've got some lovely gifts from them, and if you could give them a round of applause.